So the next topic actually brings up is Brad and 4K gaming, because he just did a big story on this.
Awesome story. And
basically, the state of 4K gaming. You know,
you shouldn't do it on that laptop.
1080. So 1080 is not going to cut it.
That one you can. That one, you can. But the little one that has a 4K screen, you should not. Should not use that.
For Are you 4K saying gaming. 1060 is not enough for 4K gaming, Brad?
That's. I mean, if you're fine with like a PS4 Pro level of 4K gaming, maybe, but ooh, not for PC gaming.
Thrown down.
It'd be half of the. It'd be half of that, I guess.
Yeah, right. If you're fine with 30 FPS, it might work. But I was looking in this piece for 60 frames per second, right? Because that's what people want on PCs. They want 60 frames per second. So I was looking to say, hey, where's 4K gaming at now? Because we last examined it the end of last year. And since then, this year, Polaris and Pascal GPUs from NVIDIA and AMD came out. And they're, you know, huge leap forward. So I was looking to see, hey, how much is it? How much do you realistically have to spend if you want to get into 4K gaming? When we looked at it last year, you would have to spend at least $1,300 to get into 4K gaming, because you'd have to get a Fury X, you'd have to get an expensive monitor, so on and so forth. So I looked at it again this year, went through the prices, so on and so forth. Monitor prices have come down significantly, and you can pick up an entry-level 4K panel now for $350, which is a ton compared to what you'll pay for a 1080p or 1440p monitor. But it's significantly less than, like, when 4K monitors first started coming out a couple years ago, they were costing $1,000. It's a huge price drop in a small amount of time. And something that's really cool about all these monitors is the majority of them have FreeSync built right in, because it's a free and open standard, and they just throw it in there. It doesn't cost any more. So for $350, you can pick up a FreeSync-enabled 4K monitor.
So you're primarily saying you do this with AMD, then, it sounds like.
I just looked at everything.
Okay.
I looked at everything in the article. To get in there as cheap as possible, you would want one of those $350 monitors. You can pick up a Fury X these days for about $380. Or a GTX 1070, which is the equivalent of last generation Titan, for about $400. So all told, between the monitor and the graphics card, you're looking to spend at least roughly $750 to get into 4K gaming. So it's significantly less than it used to be, but it's still, you know, pretty up there for most people.
And
if you want to get into G-Sync with a NVIDIA card, it adds several hundred dollars. And that's just, I'm just looking at the cost of the panel and the graphics card here. If you have to build a whole PC, if you have to upgrade your power supply, all that stuff adds cost too.
But so to me, when I hear 60 frames a second 4K, I don't think Fury X 1070 is enough, though. I always think 60. I always think Pascal Titan, right?
Yes. If you pick up a Fury X or a 1070 or a last generation Titan, you're looking, you'll get between 35 and 45 frames per second, which, you know, isn't great. It's, again, better than the PlayStation 4 Pro and Xbox Scorpio will probably do.
I can guarantee that. I can guarantee that.
Also, depending on the game, because I did upgrade to a Dell 4K monitor, and I picked up a 1070 at home, mostly because, like, my high-end photo editing, I got an A7 R2 42 megapixel like file. It's really nice to edit on a 4K screen. But Doom, like, it's super optimized, and I can do 4K, everything cranked up, and like solid like 50 on a 1070. Yeah. So that's super fun.
Nice.
Yeah, Doom is a super well optimized, beautiful, gorgeous game.
Well, yeah. Deus Ex, not so much.
in the majority of games, you'll look to get 45 frames per second tops, which, I mean, if you're coming from console gaming, that's a huge step forward. You'll think it's great, so on and so forth. A lot of people, you know, 45 frames per second, geez, that's just fine. But if you want to try to get closer to the gold standard, 60 frames per second, I agree. I can see 45 frames per second myself. If you want to start to get closer to 60 frames per second, you're going to need to spend more money on a GTX 1080. Which will get you somewhere between 45 and 60, typically, depending on the game. Or if you just want the best and you don't mind paying for it, there's the new Titan X Pascal edition.
Right.
That's $1,200. And we haven't tested it as a standalone test, But the people who have say that it'll get you to basically 60 frames per second, close to locked 100% of the time. So one of the things that's really interesting in my takeaway looking at this is last year when 4K gaming cost $1,300, it was for the One experience, because the Titan X at the time and the Fury X both cost $650. You know, they could do 4K gaming at, you know, 35 to 45 frames per second. You want a G-Sync, you want a FreeSync. This year, now, that experience is still there, but it costs less. And now, if you're willing to spend more, up to that $1,300, I mean, you could get a really, really good 4K experience at this point. So we're starting to see the market spread out a little bit.
My question, though, is it really worth it? I mean, these are, so you're looking at a 23-inch... What are you getting for that $350? How big is the panel?
27, 28 inches.
You don't
really want to. There are some 23-inch panels. They cost roughly the same. And like I was saying earlier with the laptops, I don't think 4K holds up well on that small of a screen. I think it's definitely worth it to get a 27 or 28-inch panel. And they cost virtually the same. So
does that pixel density really matter? Even at 28 inches, which is a pretty decent sized panel, that pixel density is worth the pain of going to 4K over 1440p?
It is when you're gaming, if that's what you're looking to get into. There's a very noticeable difference, because I have a 4K panel that I've been testing, and if I switch it from 4K to 1080p, it's night and day. It's a huge difference. On the desktop, I end up scaling things anyway, so it's not that big of a difference on the desktop. I don't think it's worth it. As you said, you were saying, is it worth it? If you have the money and you want to experience it, great. But to me, $750, assuming you already have a gaming PC, is just way too high cost of entry. I think 1080p gaming with no compromises or a decent 1440p is much better sweet spot.
Yeah.
Well, and you're always a big proponent for the high refresh rates, right? G-Sync?
Or variable.
I love G-Sync and FreeSync, yeah. And or high refresh rates, any of those things. Anything that makes games smooth, I love.
Over 4K.
Yes, I would. If it was my money, if I had to buy something, I would buy a 1440p monitor with a high refresh rate over a 4K monitor.
Right, so a 144. To me, optimal would be 1440p, 144, 165 refresh rate.
So I have a random question related to 4K gaming. Brad, how do you feel about building out a 4K PC gaming rig and then connecting it to 4K TV?
Useless. Don't do it. Because
why is that?
Because it's every display expert you'll ever talk to, and yourself, if you go to a store and you look at these TVs as they're supposed to be used, 4K TVs look great. I mean, they're so beautiful. They're so vibrant. You can see just how much better of a picture there are when you're standing right in front of it. When you're 10 feet away, you know, in a standard usage, like you're sitting on your couch at home looking at a TV, you cannot see differences between a 4K screen and a 1080p screen. Every expert you talk to will say that. If you go to a store and catch them next to each other, you'll say that. So, no, I don't think it's worthwhile doing that in the living room.
It might be worth upgrading for HDR. And I don't know if there's any 1080 panels that have HDR out there, but you know.
No, it's going to be 4K. But I, Brad, what you don't know, and this, I don't understand why the tech media has suppressed this information, but all of those experts, the display experts that tell you that 4K panels are not 4K televisions, that they can't tell the difference, they also, by the way, work as referees in the NFL and NBA. Okay? So I don't know if you know, but they are blind. They can't tell the difference. We have 4K sets here, and we have, you know, 4K Ultra HD Blu-rays, and it's spectacular.
It is, but you're looking at it when it's spectacular. You're looking at it close. You're not sitting across the way or anything.
Well, I mean,
if it's spectacular, it's because the different type of refresh rates, because of the different type of screens that they're using. It's not because of the resolution at 10-foot distance.
I think it is. I think if pixel density, 1080p, especially as you're getting to these 65, 70 plus inch screens, I think you can, a regular person can tell the pixel density, even at 10 feet. Now,
the bigger the screen, 70 inch screen is a huge screen. So.
Right. I mean, so I do think you can tell a difference. So I'm just saying these NBA refs moonlighting as display experts obviously can't tell the difference, right? Because, I mean, come on. I just realized that's going to be my costume for Halloween. I'm going to be an NBA ref. Perfect. Get a shirt, whistle.
Perfect.
Just call stuff in, you know, like call stuff. Not call stuff.
I'm from New England, and I'm waiting that one last game that Tom Brady's sitting out, so I don't find these referee jokes humorous.
That was a fumble, by the way. That was a fumble. So we never forget.
All right, so Brad, recommendation, 4K gaming, not worth it. Not yet.
If you have the money, unless it's awesome. For most people, it's way more cost-effective to get something else. Like I said, I have a 4K screen. Often, I turn it down to 1440p to be able to crank graphics even higher.
Yeah,
actually,
me too.
Right. So that's it's tough. I have a, and you, of course, I know your feelings on multi-card, because it seems to me a pair of 1080s would probably do pretty well at 4K, but
in those three games that support it, yeah.
Man, what is it with the whole world is turning against multi-card gaming? I don't. What's up with
that? It's not necessarily the world. It's just about being developers. Yeah, it's about being realistic about what you're actually going to get for going with that kind of setup.
Two is better than one, and three is better than two. It's simple
unless
math.
You're talking about a $700 graphics card, man.
I don't know if the scaling is all there either, Gordon.
Yeah.
It's better because three is more than two. That's simple. All right. I mean, I'm not going to. Clearly, we have different opinions on 4K gaming and televisions.